Joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have the Vice Chairperson of the Senate Committee on Foreign Relations, Senator Francis Tolentino, who is now live from Washington, D.C. Senator Tolentino, good morning to you.
Morning, Ma'am Karen. Good morning to the viewers, your viewers as well.
All right, maybe before we start, you can share, what are you doing in Washington, D.C.? Is this an official trip or related to the issue at hand?
This is an official trip. I'm with the Senate President, Senate President Zubiri. This is the first day of the trip. We are slated to meet several officials of our counterparts from the U.S. Congress, including some U.S. senators as well.
Okay. And is the trip related to the issue at hand or not necessarily?
Not necessarily. Broader issues of encompassing bilateral relations of the United States and the Philippines.
Okay. Now, speaking of bilateral relations, the United States is, in a way, exercising bilateral relations by requesting the Philippines to actually temporarily accept over, am I correct? The last number I had is 50,000 Afghan refugees. You said you were not entirely against it, but what are your concerns?
I am not entirely against it. Again, I think I was the one who initially proposed that the revival of the open door policy, similar to the policy done by President Quezon during the Second World War, wherein Russian Jews were admitted to the Philippines. So I am not against this per se. I'm not against this, but there has got to be proper vetting on the part of the United States and the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, as well as probably the determination of the timeline, how long will they be here, if this is going to be a safe house or halfway house. How long will they be here? What will be the commitment of the Philippine government aside from the site? And how sure are we that the vetted, processed Afghans would be accepted? Because in case of, there are principles of international law, a French word for it, reforma. If they're not accepted in another jurisdiction, they have to, they're not supposed to be forced to return to Afghanistan. So basically, I am for it because I think that the statements made by a labor group yesterday and Bishop today are quite in consonance with what I mentioned during the Senate hearing. We are a Catholic country. Is a principle of humanitarian law. They are supposed to be considered as refugees, not just under the 1951 Convention and its protocol, but they are refugees because refugees can be dissected into three items. One, your refugees per se, yung pinagtalunan sa Senado. Number two are the asylum seekers. And number three would be your IDPs, the internally displaced persons. These are persons still within Afghanistan, but outside their homes, persecuted, threatened to be harmed, etc., etc.
Okay, some issues now. Let's go on to detail. Did the Department of Foreign Affairs mishandle anything? Because you did cite them for this, and is there a lack of transparency in the process? What would you want them to exactly do?
I would have wanted a sole spokesperson for the DFA. Explaining all of this in layman's terms, paliwanag sa taong bayan, sandali lang po ito dito, hindi naman po talaga 50 mil ang titira. It can be less than 10,000 because there are other 3 or 4 or 5 countries willing to have them process as well. So dapat na ipaliwanag ng DFA. Dapat sa simula pa lang si DFA, siya na yung nagsasalita, hindi na umabot doon sa marami pang committee, yung interagency, anti-terror task force, etc., etc. So si DFA siguro ang nag-mismanage, no offense to them, kaibigan ko Secretary Manalo, yung paglalabas ng initial communications. Uulitin ko yung sinabi ko. These are not your terrorists. These are not your suicide bombers. These are lady educators. These are translators. Hindi ito yung mga nakasabit sa eroplano. Why are we trying to stereotype and discriminate against our, diba, ang dami nating mga anti-discriminatory laws, and then here we are acting as a member global community like trying to have that image with a discriminatory, discriminating against Afghans. Bakit ganon? Samantalang yung mga FW natin, pag pumupunta sa ibang bansa, tinatanggap naman po lahat yan. Hindi naman na-discriminate po siguro, employer na yon. Pero hindi yung bansa na tumanggap sa kanila. Bakit po natin pinipilit na binabranda pag Muslim ay masama? Hindi naman po siguro totoo yon. So, ginawa na natin ito nung Vietnam War, hindi naman natin sinabi nung pagpumunta dito yung mga South Vietnamese, ilalala yung problema natin sa insurgency. Dahil mataas po yung populasyon noon ng New People's Army. Wala naman kung ganun nangyari nung pinapasok natin yung mga South Vietnamese during the height of the Vietnam War.
You know, that's a very powerful statement you just made, Senator Francis Tolentino. And I'd like to continue with that because Vice President Sara Duterte actually, for the benefit of our viewers, she actually wrote the Anti-Terror Council, I believe, and cited the reasons why she was against the hosting of Afghan refugees. And she said that one, she cited possible security threats and even violations of the country's sovereignty. Let's start with the possible security threats. This was discussed also by Defense Secretary Gibo Teodoro in the Senate hearing. Sagutin po natin yun.
Alam niyo po, yung sa pagkakaalam ko, hindi naman ako kasali dun sa mga interagency task force or task forces. Naka-confine po sila. Para mas maliwanag po sa ating mga kababayan, ano po yung naka-confine? Naka-quarantine sila. Naka-quarantine sila sa isang lugar, hindi sila makakalabas hanggat hindi matatapos yung pagproseso ng kanilang visa. Siguro po pinakamahaba na yung 90 days at saka pa lang sila alis. Pag alis nila, papunta na sila sa either Germany, Australia, Canada, or the United States, o malamang United States. So in terms of security risk, nandun lang sila sa isang lugar. Kung saan yung lugar yon, hindi ko alam kung sa Laor, sa Nueva Ecija, o sa Clark Air Base, kung saan man. Pero nakakulong lang sila, naka-quarantine sila. Wala po ako nakita ang security risk doon. So again, I respect the views of the Vice President. Siguro hindi na ipaliwanag ng gusto ni Secretary Manalo. Kaya umabot tayo sa ganitong punto na ang image na lumalabas ay confusing at hindi maliwanag kaagad. So I mentioned this during the hearing na may pagkukulang po dito ang DFA. Bakit nila parang tinililihim? Bakit nila parang tinatago? Bakit nila parang binibiglaan nila ngayon? Dapat nagkaroon po ng konsultasyon na maaga pa lang para na ipaliwanag na ito. Involved even the leadership of the Bangsamoro regional autonomous region. So para lahat po, even the Commission on Women, kasi ang dami yung kababaihan dito, and even our security forces. So yun lang po siguro ang pagkukulang ng Department of Foreign Affairs.
Okay, what about the supposed sovereignty issues? You can correct this kung mali ang pagkakaintindi, no? It says here that the Philippines won't have the right to determine who could enter the country and who could stay, either temporarily or permanently. But clearly it's temporarily, right? Yes. It says that the United States will be vetting the Afghan refugees flying in from Kabul. Is there a misconception with that particular report?
Ang lumalabas po sigurong sovereignty issue ay parang dinidiktahan tayo na magdala dito ng dayuhan at parang napipili tayo. Hindi po. Tayo rin po ang magdidetermine kung saan lugar, kung ganong karami. At may karapatan din po tayong sabihin kung sino man yung magdadala dito na tama na yan, ganito lang yung karami. But Karen, to really clarify, I'm not the spokesman of the DFA. Aside from being the original signatory, one of the original signatories of the United Nations Declaration of yung human rights, si Secretary Carlos Piro Romulo Pahonon, ang Pilipinas po kagaya po ng ibang bansa ay naniniwala dun sa tinatawag na Martens Principle. There's a Martens Principle of humanity. This is a provision in international humanitarian law that even in the absence of a specific treaties, lahat po ng bansa ay dapat saklulohan, tulungan po yung nangangailangan. Bahagi po tayo ng community of nations. So bilang bahagi tayo ng isang international community of nations, meron pong bahagi ng ating soberenya na nilagak na natin kasama sila. So part of our sovereignty is was earmarked as part of our membership of that global community that humanity that Martin's clause was I referred to a while ago. So hindi po nabawasan yung ating soberenya, bagkus nadagdagan po. Nadagdagan dahil kinilala natin yung karapatan ng mga nangangailangan na tanggapin naman sila. I was informed during my brief stint here, ilang oras pa lang ako rito, meron nung isang eroplano ng laman ay puro Afghanistan a few days ago. Nakasakay na sila sa eroplano, nalaman ng mga Taliban, pinabalik. Pinabalik. Ngayon din na po malaman kung nasaan sila. Mga kababaihan po at mga bata, mga kabataan. So, hindi pa po tayo naalarma sa ganun. At salita tayo ng salita kami, investigate na investigate, human trafficking, kung ano-ano. E ito, right before the eyes of the entire world, may mga ganito nangyayari. At hindi natin, maliit lang po yung ating i-contribute para mabawasan naman po itong ganitong pagkaapi na kahit po ibang lahi, bahagi nga tayo ng kapatid din po natin yan. Signatory po tayo sa napakaraming tratado ng United Nations.
Okay. All right. Now, is this legal? These are some questions that were posed in the Senate hearing. You did cite the agreements that we've signed, even the United Nations that we are a signatory. They've questioned, Senator Aimee Marcos has questioned propriety. Some have questioned, is this legal? Is the Philippines capable if we host them? Can we manage it? The NBI even mentioned the possibility of sleeper cells. So clearly it's gotten more than just opening the country to refugees on a temporary basis. There seems to be a different fear when it comes to these Afghan refugees, in which you've cited, are we discriminating them with these arguments?
Ma'am, it is legal. It is legal because we're bound. We're bound to comply with several treaties, specifically the first treaty that I mentioned, United Nations Declaration on Human Rights. At napakarami po, including various international humanitarian laws and even Philippine laws. Before President Duterte stepped down, he issued Executive Order Number 163 relative to the situation of the Rohingya refugees and other asylum seekers. So, maging ang ating saligang batas ay under Article 17, Section 7, would allow this. So, ang dami po, in 1951 Convention Relating Status of Refugees, 1967 Protocol, Stateless Persons, etc. Hindi ko na po babanggitin yan. Kaya po ba ng resources natin? Wala nga tayong gagastos yan eh.
Oo.
Gagastos po nito yung magpapadalang bansa. And I think the UN High Commissioner for Refugees would also be involved. It would have to be a global effort as well. At kasama na nga yung Australia, kasama na yung Germany, kasama po yung Canada. They have programs for this, including the United Kingdom. So I don't see any reason to hype the hysteria all over again. Is it legal to help a fellow human being in need? Is it illegal to provide a temporary shelter for someone in need? I don't see anything wrong. States of conscience, morality, and principles of international law would justify all of this. Okay. Meron hype kasi lalong-lalo na pag nabinrand yung mga Afghans na terrorists. Mm-mm. Kaya nga sabi ko, hindi naman terrorist lahat po ng ating mga kapatid na Muslim. Ito nga po yung gusto nang umalis doon kasi inaapi na sila. And we have the chance to help them. Similar to what other countries are doing to help our OFWs as well.
Okay. Now, the argument that you just made, I mean, you have Senator Aimee Marcos and Senator Jingoy Estrada saying, for example, is it proper To host these individuals while thousands of Filipinos are displaced by the 2017 siege in Marawi and there are still waiting for temporary shelters. Senator Estrada says, is it proper to house them while so many Filipinos don't have housing? How do you respond to these arguments that it seems to be an either or? If we can't help our own, why should we help them?
I think, ma'am, no offense to my colleagues, and with all due respect, the comparison is not that clear and probably should have no basis that would entail domestic internally displaced persons as well as these Afghan groups. Tayo po magdedetermine dito kung ilan yung atin tatanggapin. Wala na tayong gagastusin. On the other hand, yung kabila, yung unang pinag-uusapan, tayo naman po yung based on our resources kung ilan yung ating houses na pagagawa, saan sila dadalhin, sa Iligan, sa Cagayan de Oro. Dapat tulungan po yan. I'm a member of the Marawi Compensation Fund Committee. So in terms of priority pa rin natin yung ating mga kababayan. But in terms of generating resources for this, wala naman tayong kukunin para alisin sa kababayan ng Pilipinas at ilipat doon sa maalis doon sa ating mga kababayan Muslim dito sa ating bansa. So ito pong planong gawin, pwede nating hindihan. Pwedeng matuloy. Pwedeng matuloy, pwedeng 50,000, pwedeng 500, pwedeng 1,000. So hindi tayo pinupwersa dito. It is our moral obligation to do this. Okay. Similar to the internally displaced persons coming from the Marawi siege, it is likewise the duty of the government to provide housing programs and livelihood assistance to our displaced Filipino brothers here. So there is no question. There is no demarcation line. There should be no delineation insofar as providing humanitarian assistance. Yung prioritization, siguro nagkamali lang dito yung DFA kung paano ipaliwanag po ito.
Oo. May punto kayo, parang ganito eh. Parang alangan naman tayo lang ang humihingi ng tulong sa ibang bansa. Pag kinailangan naman ng tulong, nasan tayo doon?
Oh, diba? You can be the spokesperson, ma'am, of the DFA.
Hindi naman. Napaisip lang ako, sir, because you make strong points. Actually, you make good arguments for the UNHCR. The United Nations HCR is advocating for the plight of refugees all over the world. But let's move on to another.
Tingnan niyo po ito, ma'am. Lagi po tayong sinasabihan ng European Union. Lagi po tayong sinasabihan ng ilang bansa na hindi tayo tumutupad sa human rights obligation natin. Itong ginagawa natin ito, this is the highest form of compliance with human rights obligations. Yung tanggapin mo yung mga nangangailangan na mga kababaihan, mga nanggagaling sa Afghanistan. Ano pa ba kung wala na ho tayong patutunayan dito? This is the highest level of compliance with international humanitarian laws and human rights obligations of the Philippines.
Okay. Moving now to another issue. You are in Washington, D.C. right now overall to talk about bilateral relations with the United States. Where does the West Philippine Sea come in? Will there be topics, for example, on maritime drills together? What about exploration of the West Philippine Sea? What will it cover, sir?
I am not yet kadarating ko lang, ma'am. Hindi ko pa, but I still maintain my position that maritime drills should involve not just the United States. I even proposed my own version of the Quad to include Japan, Australia, United States, and the Philippines. In fact, ongoing na ata at nagsimula na yung trilateral ng Japan, Philippines, and the United States, and eventually we'll have Australia. So the more countries participating in these exercises, including perhaps in the future South Korea, would augur well for freedom of navigation, compliance with international with UNCLOS. So I will still maintain that exploration would. And in any exploration endeavor, Philippine laws should prevail.
All right.
Resources natin yun.
Okay. Is there anything you'd like to add, Senator, before we go?
Will you now allow me to sleep, ma'am?
Okay, yes. Go ahead, sir. You just landed and I want to thank you for joining me on Kickstart.
Good evening. It's almost 8:25 here in Washington.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much, Senator Francis Tolentino, live in Washington, D.C. Thank you.